Okay, so we're going to look at setting up linear programming problems. And in order to look at setting up linear programming problems, we're obviously going to need to know what the actual structure of a linear programming problem looks like. So the first thing to consider and just to remind ourselves about is a linear programming problem is an optimization problem. Okay, so it's an optimization problem. And that means that obviously you're optimizing something. You're trying to find some optimal value. And that means that there will be something like a minimum or maximum, you know, requirement. You want to either minimize, say, cost or maximize profit. Those are like the main ones that you would think of or consider. So a linear programming problem is an optimization problem. It is an optimization problem in which all the equations are linear. And we will discuss this now. And that means that there will be a structure to it. So it's kind of like a mathematical, you know, thing where it's basically saying you're going to minimize or maximize some function subject to some sort of conditions. Okay, so it's you have your objective, which is a minimization or maximize, and then there'll be some conditions, you know, which are going to limit how the minimization or maximization occurs. And we will refer to the optimization aspect, the minimize and maximize, as your objective function, because that is generally your objective. And then you'll have the conditions set, you know, to constrain the objective function is called your constraints. And at this moment in time, you'll also have a situation where you look at or you'll consider things and be like, well, the function obviously has to have variables because, you know, in order to minimize or maximize something, you need to consider something, you know, to get to that point. So there will be decision variables, which both the conditions and the objective function will require. And obviously, I'm just speaking here without the mathematics. So let's go into the structure in the more mathematical terms. So the first thing that you're going to need to consider is that there's always going to be a layout to this kind of problem. So you're going to have, obviously, your optimization, whatever you're going to optimize. And that's going to be, again, either your max or your min. And it is a function. And it is a function made up of the decision variables. So say you were like a farmer and you have a set number of apples and pears. And a situation, okay, it's going to be completely different to that. It's not going to be the individual apple or pears. It's going to be like your trees. If you get what I mean by that, you would have your decision variables as the apples and pears, and maybe you want to maximize your profit based on that. So how many you sell, what your markup is going to be, and so on. Or you want to minimize your cost. And again, your cost will be related to, you know, the production of that singular apple in this case. Again, very bad example that I gave you, but that's where we're going with this. In regards to there will be decision variables, and the decision variables will impact what your objective function does. The decision variables are usually directly correlated to what you want to optimize. So if it's cost, there will be a direct relation with the variable and say a cost of an item and so on. Then it's going to be subject to, and it's going to be subject to those constraints I spoke about or the conditions on it. So you'll have the subject to, and then there'll be a bunch of functions. Now, I talk about it as functions. Remember, those are just basically equations. But they're going to be linear inequality equations or equality equations. So when I write it like this, I'm going to write it in a very general term, but we will discuss this as soon as I finish writing it. So you have like some function, there's a bunch of them, there's a number of them, because you can have a ton of constraints, like, you know, going back to those apples and pears, you could have a situation of you only have a set number of seeds or land or, you know, people that can maintain the crops kind of a situation. So you'll have functions and they're linear inequalities. So they're either going to be less than or equal to, and greater than or equal to, or less than or greater than. And it's going to be some constant variable in this case, because it's a linear function, some constant variable. And again, it's I, because there's however many, if I is equal to 3, then we'll have 3 constraint equations. If I is equal to 1, we only have 1 constraint equation, and so on. And then we're going to need to consider the fact that and we have written it in here. The function f relies on the decision variables, and the constraints also rely on the decision variables. So it depends on the unknowns. So the decision variables are the unknowns, because they're what we wanted to work out. How many do we need of them? Are the unknowns, which is x1, x2, all the way to xn, and that means that there are n of them. Okay, so not a huge deal in regards to this, but this is just to explain, you know, the basic structure of the linear programming problem and going from there. So again, let's just go through the naming of it. This is your objective function, because it is your objective is to minimize or maximize, and it's the function that is going to allow us, you know, to see how to do that. Subject two, and it's the things that are constraining your objective function, because once again, if you have profit, there are going to be variables to hold the amount that you can make of an item or something like that. So there'll be constraints on it. So this part here is the constraints. And then, you know, the fact that the functions are dependent on these decision variables, which are the unknowns, it's what you want to solve for. Like, if you want to maximize the profit, how many apples and pears should you have? And how many apples and pears you should have will be dependent on certain constraints. They will hopefully have different, you know, variables in regards to growing them, which is going to impact the profit outcome. Okay, so one thing just to I wrote this in terms of functions, but what's going to be there specific is it's a linear programming problem. So when we talk about these functions, and say we have fx1 and x2, because most of the time we're going to handle only two variables. That's basically just like a straight line situation. So it'd be things like 3x1 plus 4x2, you know, or 3.5x1 plus 5x2, or 7a plus 8b, or minus 5a, you know, plus 7b kind of situation. It's just linear equations that is occurring there. And these are all, so that is a function of x1 and x2. This is, and I don't want to call it g because I'm using g there. It can also be a function of x1 and x2. This is a function of a and b. And this is, again, a function of a and b. So just bear in mind with the way I write it and, you know, what exactly is it representing. Then you also have that situation of the gi ones. If I talk about that and I have like 3x1 plus 4x2 less than or equal to 5, this would be, you know, that b aspect. This would be g1, which is a function of x1 comma x2 less than or equal to b. So just bear that in mind. So the whole idea that you just need to consider is you are building up a linear programming problem which has an objective, and that objective is to optimize something. That optimization is a minimization or maximization, and it's subject to obviously a bunch of constraints. But because you're working in the linear programming, you know, the linear world, all your equations are going to be linear. So there's going to be no squares happening anywhere. You know, there's going to be no x1 times x2. It is literally just going to be that situation where your x's are, you know, by themselves and your y's are kind of by themselves in the equation. Okay, so you're like, great, so that is the structure of the linear programming problem, but then you have to go into the setting up. So setting up is basically from taking a word problem, which is currently displaying on your screen, and then putting that word problem into that mathematical structure. That does take some work and does take some effort, and you may struggle with this a little bit. So I'm going to try and work through a couple of ways that you can look at the word problem to get the information that you need. So the first way, I'm just going to utilize, you know, the method where you just highlight things and work it out kind of situation. Then I'm going to just introduce you to a little bit of a slightly of a trick way to get to where you need to go. And that is creating or building tables to kind of help you figure out what the decision variables and stuff are. But we're going to go through the process, like what you should look out for and how is that going to tell you what the decision variables are, or you know what your objective function is, and so on. So here we have an example of ZZ Electronics. They own two small factories where they manufacture two types of cellular phones. Okay, so you have two types of cellular phones, H2 and minus. Then let's talk about H2 requires 10 man hours to manufacture and 3 hours for testing. So there's two separate pieces of information occurring here. So they have this testing and they have this manufacturing. Then we have the minus cell phone has eight man hours to manufacture and 4 man hours for testing. And the manufacturing department has a maximum of 800 hours available per week. So I don't want to talk about it yet, but hint there, the word maximum gives you a bit of a clear direction of what's occurring there. If it has a maximum amount of things, that is a constraint. You know, it's just like a thought process to think about when you're going through this work. Well, the testing department has a maximum of 360 man hours available per week. Okay, so again, that maximum is kind of leading you onto the idea that it is a constraint. The factory has to manufacture at least 60 of the minus models each week. And again, this at least creates a bit of a like a constraint kind of a situation because, you know, it's a target that needs to be met. So at least 60 of the minus models each week. Then they talk about the profit of the H2 phone is 200 Rand, while the profit of one minus phone is 270 Rand. And they go, okay, how many of each type of phone must the company manufacture to maximize profit? So in this example, it's actually really clear that your objective is to maximize the profit. It's literally stated there. So you do kind of know what the objective function is. It's maximize the profit. Now you have to consider how is the profit built up. So in the situation, we talk about, well, we don't talk about, we get told that the profit of the H2 phone is 200 and the profit of one minus phone is 270. And that's like a glaring thing that your decision variables are going to be the minus phone numbers and the H2 phone numbers, because here you have a situation where it's like literally saying, listen, one phone is 200 rands worth of profit. So how many phone, well, what is your profit if you have five of those phones? Well, it's 5 times 200. And then you're like, okay, well, that five is obviously just a number sucked up my head, but you're like, okay, well, then it's going to be 200 times a decision variable, which is dependent on how many H2 phones there are. So you have the situation of, you know, 200 times the number of H2 phones is a part of the profit, plus 270 times the number of minus phones. So that's going to be like, again, indicating to you what the decision variables are going to be, because when you write out your objective function, your objective function is a function of your decision variables. So in this case, there's two decision variables, but that means, you know, here, that's the number of H2 phones and that's the number of minus phones. So that would be like the number of H2 phones and that could be the number of minus phones. Or you can use X and Y if you don't like X1 and X2. So you have to go through and you have to read very, very carefully to see what is going on and how to approach it. Next, you have to look at the constraints. So here we've already identified the decision variables. So we know that those constraints are going to involve the number of H2 phones and the number of minus phones. If they don't involve that, you either go back and check to see if your decision variables make sense, or and if they don't necessarily make full sense, look at the constraints to try and figure out what the decision variables are. Or it's a case of, you know, going to actually check if your objective function is the correct objective function. That could also be an error. So just bear that in mind that now, if you've identified that the number of H2 phones and the number of minus phones are the decision variables, they need to feature in all your constraints. Not necessarily both of them, but they should be featuring in your constraints. Because the reason why I say not necessarily both, one of them may, you know, not feature in a very specific constraint. And I'll show you an example of that in like a few minutes. Okay, so let's go back to the top of it. And it says H2 cellular phone requires 10 man hours to manufacture and 3 man hours in the testing department. Now, your first thought could just be like, oh, well, I'm going to put 10x1 plus 3x1. Because there it says, okay, fine, you know, it requires 10 hours. So each phone, 10 times however many number of phones, be the number of manufacturing hours. And you have your testing department, same kind of situation. But you have to consider the constraint aspect. So where is it actually being constrained? So in this case, you need to continue your reading. And I just want to rub this out before I continue talking. You need to continue your reading and look at where are the constraints. So remember, we spoke about the fact that the maximum indicates its constraint. So there are 800 man hours available per week. So you have 800 man hours in the manufacturing department. So you should be looking at everything connected to manufacturing and constraining it by that 800 hours available. So then you'll look at the H2 cellular phone requiring 10 man hours per, you know, phone. But then you also have to consider the number of man hours for the minus phones. So in this case, again, you look for what, you know, what is actually being constrained and then what makes up that constraint. So you'll have that plus 8x2, and then it's going to be less than or equal to the 800. Why less than or equal to? Because it has a maximum of 800 man hours per week, so up to 800. So it includes 800 and anything less than. And then you'll go through, you know, looking for your constraints again. So notice my objective function had the x1 and the x2. You know, this constraint also has that kind of structure. It has the x1 and the x2. And the x1 and the x2 mean the same things, you know, in both the equations. Then you look for the next constraint. The next constraint is the testing department has a maximum of 360 man hours available per week. So you have how much, you know, for the X1 is 3, and that 3 is coming from over there, and 4 for the X2, and less than or equal to 360. Okay, so we have that constraint. And then we have that other constraint that we're looking at, because it uses the word at least. At least 60 of the minus models each week needs to be made. So in this case, there is a constraint that only relates to the minus models. So you have, okay, my minus models are indicated by X2. So the number of them is X2. And I have to have at least 60 of them. So X2 must be greater than or equal to 60. Right, so we've actually covered everything in this word problem. But one other thing to note is that you can't have a negative amount of the you know, decision variables in this situation. So your X1 and your X2 must be greater than or equal to 0. So that's like almost like a freebie for you in most situations, that x1 and x2 greater than or equal to 0. Because your decision variables, you can't, when you're looking at units of something, you can't have negative units of something. They're a physical quantity. So often, majority of the time, you're going to have that x1 and x2 greater than or equal to 0 in your linear programming problems that you set up. Okay, so for the majority of the kind of problems that you'll handle, at least, there is another way that we can go about it. And even if it doesn't necessarily work in your case, you will automatically see it. So the idea is to actually build up a table. So what we mean by that is just take your information and start writing it in table format. So in this case, we have, you know, ZZ Electronics owns the two small factories, which manufacture two types of cellular phones, the H2 and the minus. And you'd be like, okay, well, there's the H2 and there's the minus. They each have their own row. And then you continue reading. You go, well, here we have H2 requires 10 man hours to manufacture. And because it's information specific to H2, you create it, like in this case, because we have the H2 as a row, you create a column that it talks about manufacturing. and you write down information related to it. So there's 10 hours there, okay? So manufacturing hours, you put in 10, and then you go, okay, and 3 hours in the testing department, you go, oh, that's a new piece of information, a new column because it's related to H2, so it gets its own column. So you have the testing hours. And you have, okay, that is 3. Then each minor cellular phone requires 8 hours to manufacture, so you can put that in as well. So you can have the 8 over there, and you can put in, you know, the 4 hours per testing department. And then you move on, you go, okay, well, the manufacturing department has a maximum of 800 hours per week. And you can go and you can, okay, where is my manufacturing hours represented? Well, it's represented, you know, in this column here. So what I can do is at the end of that column, so listen, it can only have a maximum 800 of those. So let's have the less than equal to 800 just written there at the moment. As you know, a disclaimer that that column can only have, you know, 800. Then you move on and the testing department has a maximum of 360 man hours per week. And you can do the same for that as well. So you can be like, okay, well, it has a limit of 360. Then the factory has to manufacture at least 60 of the minus models. So let's add another column, must manufacture column. And you're like, okay, well, it needs 60 of these. So you're like, okay. When we look at this and we are referring to the fact that at least 60 of the minus models, so you're going to have greater than 60, there's 0 times however many H2 models you have, and 1 times however many minus models must be greater than or equal to 60. So when you write it down in, you know, your column, you have thus manufactured column. There are no constraints on the H2, so it's going to have 0 there, but at the moment you could have left it as, you know, blank because you're not sure. And you go, okay, connected, directly connected to the number of minus models, so the 1 sits there in greater than or equal to 60. And then it talks about the profit, and it says, okay, the profit on the H2 is 200 rand, so you have, like, profit here, and that's 200, and then the profit on 1 minus phone is 270. So now, that's all your information. You've covered all your information. And if you look at this table, you can actually figure out where your constraints are and what is your objective. Because your constraints have inequalities and your objective does not. And you can figure out what your decision variables are based on, you know, the fact that when you're reading this, you know it has to follow the structure of like AX1 plus BX2 less than or equal to or greater than or equal to, so on. So you have that situation of, you have your decision variables. Your decision variables are the H2 and the minus numbers. So you have X1 and you have X2. And that X1 gets repeated everywhere. And X2, X1, X2. And remember, that's a 0 times there. And then you have your X1 and you have your X2. So you can see automatically the profit one does not have that inequality sign. And moving on from there, you have your constraints occurring. And when you read them now, you have 10x1 plus 8x2 is less than or equal to 800. You know, your 3x1 plus your 4x2 is less than or equal to 360. Your x2 greater than or equal to 60. And your objective function of 200x1 plus 270x2. So you can write it as a table. Now, at this moment in time, you may be like, right, but what if I put H2 and minus as columns? And it's going to work out the same way. So let's just do that quickly. Okay, so we put in H2 over here and minus over here. So then we have the two columns representing them. Then we go on and we go, once again, we say, okay, each H2 cellular phone requires 10 man hours to manufacture. So because your H2 and your minus are columns, you have your manufacturing hours, you know, as rows. And again, you have the 10 occurring there and the 8 for the minus. And you have, in this case, less than or equal to 800 going in that, you know, that approach. Then you'd have your testing, and your testing is your 3 and your 4, and less than or equal to your 360. You would then have your must manufacture, and that would be your 0 and your 1, and that would be greater than or equal to 60. And then you'd have your profit, which is 200 of the H2s and 270 of the minuses occurring. And then once again, you can see your constraints are the ones with the inequalities occurring there, and all the equalities, depending on what your constraint is. And the one without anything is your objective function and your decision variables. You read your constraints, and remember, you read it like that. So you'd have your X1 and your X2 occurring there. And it does make sense because your X1 represents your H2, so it will go all the way down these columns like that. Okay, so there is, you can use like tables to help you out a bit. There will be situations where the tables won't be very clear cut, which is why I do recommend that you go through, just going through like, what is it asking? What are your decision variables and so on, just to help you out. But you can use a combination of both of them to figure it out, or particularly if you're not 100% sure, you know, you can go through this process to clarify, to make sure that, you know, it is as it should be kind of situation. Okay, now one thing that's very important to note, which I haven't looked at yet, is taking those equations that you had and putting them in the correct order. So remember, there is a specific layout on how you must set it up, and it's the objective function subject to the constraints. So you should actually do that. And you also need to tell the reader or user, whoever who's looking at this model, what those decision variables actually are. So let's write out, you know, the proper form or the proper mathematical structure for that linear programming problem that we kind of built up in a very rough way. So we had H2 is X1. So you say, let X1 be the number of H2 phones produced. And let X2 be the number of minus phones produced. Now, this step is actually very, very important, because if you don't know what those decision variables mean, that mathematical model is kind of useless to you. Then you have, you know, your maximize, and then you have your profit, and you have your 200 X1 plus 270 X2, okay, which is your objective function. So again, you have a description of what the decision variables actually mean. Then you have your objective function. Then you're going to have your constraints. So you're going to have subject to or such as, you know, and it's going to be listing your constraints. In this case, it's going to be the 10x1 plus the 8y less than equal to 800, your 3x1 plus your 4. And you'll notice I switched variables here. I shouldn't have done that. X2, x2 less than equal to 360. Y x2 greater than or equal to 60, and then the x1 and x2 greater than or equal to 0. So here you have all your constraints then. So you have what are your decision variables actually representing, your objective function, and then the constraints. And one of the things you can do, this will make your life a lot easier, particularly if you're investigating this problem later or solving this problem, is being very specific of what those constraints relate to. So you could write, you know, manufacturing, you could write testing, you know, you could write minus models constraint in brackets after that. But the main idea is you're not finished with your mathematical model by just putting your constraint equations down and putting your objective function down. It has a very specific format that you need to follow, which is, what are the decision variables representing? What is the objective function? Is it maximize or minimize? This part is very important. And then subject to, and then all your constraints, including the fact that your decision variables should be greater than or equal to 0. Okay, so this is another example, and obviously this is a minimization case example. And again, you're going to have to look at your word problem and figure out from your word problem, you know, what exactly is the structure of your mathematical model. So we're going to do it again by just reading it and trying to figure out from reading it, pointing out some of the things that, you know, should be signs of what exactly it is referring to. and going through the process from there. So here we have a travel agency has to transport a minimum of 1,200 passengers. So yeah, it's already, it's throwing you into some sort of constraint because it's saying has to transport a minimum of 1,200 passengers and 36,000 kgs of luggage from one airport to another. And there are two types of aircraft available. So they say, okay, the Silverjet can transport a maximum of 120 passengers and 200 kgs of luggage in one flight. So what's really interesting here is the way that it's worded, you would automatically start thinking, okay, the 1,200 passengers is a constraint, the 120 passengers is a constraint. But be very careful about this. So we're going to continue reading and then we're going to discuss that. So it also says that the Golden Flyer can transport a maximum of 60 people and 3,000 kgs of luggage in one flight. And the travel agency may not use more than 16 aircraft. Okay, so that also sounds like a constraint. So like you're reading all of this and like everything sounding like a constraint. And then it says the rental of the Silverjet is 40,000 rand per flight and 48,000 for the Golden Flyer. And they say how many of each aircraft must the travel agency hire in order to minimize the cost. Now this line here is really helping you out because one, you know that the objective function is to minimize the cost. So you have minimize cost. And you're like, okay, well, what is going to get me that cost? Well, the cost of everything is the rental of the two types of aircraft. So that's going to tell you that the two types of aircraft are parts of the decision variables. Now, what exactly the decision variables are, whether they're the numbers of them, or hours, or whatever, is going to be impacted by what exactly is any cost associated with this connected to. So here it's connected to a Silverjet per flight. So the decision variable we are how many Silverjet flights, you know, are going to be utilized. So in this, again, the rental is per flight. So when we look at this and go, okay, well, this 40,000 times the number of flights per, of Silverjet flights, number of Silverjet flights plus 48,000, the number of Golden Flyer flights. Okay, so we kind of already now know what the decision variables are. They're the number of Silverjet flights and the number of Golden Flyer flights. But let's go through, you know, the rest of our work to actually confirm that that is the case. So we go back to the top and it says a travel agency has to transport a minimum of 1,200 passengers. So we know that somewhere there is going to be, you know, that greater than or equal to 1,200 occurring. And it's connected to the passengers. And you're like, okay, that's great and everything, but our decision variables are the number of Silverjet flights and the number of Golden Flyer flights. Well, that's what we think at this moment in time. So then we have to look at what other further information do we have? And let's just go by order. So we're like, okay, there's also that 36,000. So greater than or equal to 36,000 to do with the luggage. So right now we don't actually have equations. We just have, you know, these random, you know, inequalities at the moment with no variables attached to them. We have the two types of aircraft available. We have the Silverjet and the Golden Flyer. Sweet, that is part of our decision variables. So we kind of sorted on that front. Then it says the Silverjet can transport a maximum of 120 passengers. And the maximum makes you think, okay, well, less than or equal to 120 kind of a situation. But now you have to think about the fact that when you're looking at this and when you're a travel agency, you are going to obviously try to fit, you know, all 120, you know, fill all the seats with 120 passengers. You're not going to want to half, you know, this. You're going to want to fill up your aircraft with as much as it can possibly carry. So when we look at this, we're like, okay, we can read the statement as the Silverjet can transport 120 passengers. And then we suddenly like, well, that can actually fit into our constraint with, you know, we need to transport at least 1,200 passengers. So we can be like, well, every single Silver Jet flight can transport 120 passengers. So then we have the 120 times the number of Silver Jet lights. Okay, so that features there in that constraint. And then the 2,000 kgs of luggage in one flight, again, you're not going to want to do less than, because the whole idea is you want to minimize the cost, which means you want to minimize the number of flights that you're doing. So in the situation, you'd have that 2,000 with the number of Silver Jet flights. Okay. Then you move on to the Golden Flyer, and the Golden Flyer is a maximum of 60, and then the 3,000. So you'll have that 60 times the Golden Flyer, you know, the number of Golden Flyer flights. And that'll be the plus situation there, plus the 3,000, the number of Golden Flyer flights. Then you look at the travel agency may not use more than 16 aircraft. So when we're talking about that, and we look at the rental of a Silver Jet is 40,000 Rand for a flight and 48,000 Rand for the Golden Flyer, we can kind of assume that that 16 aircraft means that they will only be able to utilize aircraft 16 times. And that's just a slightly badly written, you know, word problem there. So you can have that situation of, well, and this goes away, remember, because we discussed that 120 goes to the passenger constraint. Well, then we can just look at, well, the number of Silver Jet flights, plus the number of Golden Flyer flights must be less than or equal to 16, because there must only be 16 flights in total kind of situation. Because you could see yourself as renting 16 aircraft at once, and that's 16 flights. And then obviously you cannot have a negative aircraft, so you're going to have the number of Silver Jet and the number of Golden Flyer greater than or equal to 0. So here I have not put it into X and Y yet. Let's put it into X and Y. So let's make X be the number of Silver Jet flights and Y be the number of Golden Flyer flights. So this is different. I did it slightly differently to the first one where we had X1 and X2. Again, as long as you're consistent with your variables, you're sorted on that front. And then we can just, you know, put in that's Y, that's X, that's Y, that's X, that's Y, that's X, and that's Y, and rewrite it. So remember, when you're doing this, your mathematical program has that, or your linear programming problem has that very specific structure. So let's write down that structure, neaten it up. So if someone is reading it, you know, it makes sense. So we have, let X be the number of Silver Jet flights, or Silver Jets used, you know, by the travel agency. Let Y be the number of Golden Flyer jets or flights, depending on how you want to represent it. Then it's going to be, in this case, minimize the cost, which is 40,000 X plus 48,000 Y. And you usually wouldn't call it cost, you'd usually, you know, call it something like C is equal to, or Z is a common one. Okay, and then subject to, and you'll write all your constraints. So it's going to be 120X plus 60Y is greater than or equal to 1,200, and those are the passengers. Then you're going to have your 2,000X plus 3,000Y must be greater than or equal to 36,000, and that is your luggage. And then we have the X plus the Y is less than or equal to 16, and that is the aircraft. And then you're going to have your X and your Y greater than or equal to 0. So once again, you're putting it in the order that you need to put it in to make it look like a mathematical model. And once again, it's the discuss what the decision variables are, the objective function, and then the constraints. Okay, so now we're just going to do the table with as little thinking as possible. So when you're doing this, you can just go in and you can be like, okay, a travel agency has transported a minimum of 1,200 passengers. So you say, okay, passengers sits here, and we have the 1,200, and it is a minimum, so it must be greater than or equal to. So you're like, okay, passengers has its own row, and obviously there is a column for the greater than or equal to 1,200. And 36,000 kgs of luggage from one airport to another. So you're like, okay, let's make another row for luggage. There is 36,000. Okay, and you move on. So you've done that, you've done that, you've written it down. There are two types of aircraft available. Okay, sweet. The Silver Jet can transport a maximum of 120 passengers. It's like, oh, so there is going to be something related to passengers with the Silver Jet. So you give the Silver Jet a column and you indicate things that are connected to the passengers. Now, again, you have that situation where it says a maximum of 120 passengers and you can possibly get confused at this point. So you may possibly say something like, you know, less than or equal to 120. Then you move on, you like 2,000 kgs of luggage, less than or equal to 2,000. Okay. And then you move on again and you say, well, oh, Golden Fly information. So Golden Fly gets its column. Okay. And it has, you know, that less than or equal to 60 and the less than or equal to 3,000. Now, at the moment, it's not looking very good for your table, but you'll get there. And then it says the travel agency may not use more than 16 aircraft. And you're like, oh, okay. There is a limit on the number of aircraft. And obviously, the number of aircraft is directly related to the Silver Jet and the Golden Flyer. Right? And they may not use more than 16 of them. So you have that less than or equal to 16 sitting there. So less than or equal to 16 aircraft. And there's the one and one of both of those. Then you move on to continue reading and go, well, the rental of the Silver Jet flight is 40,000 and then 48,000 for the Golden Flyer. So you're like, okay, 40,000 and 48,000. And yeah, you're really like, when you hit the aircraft constraint, you're already like going, oh, well, my Silver Jet is going to be a variable. My Golden Flyer is going to be a variable. But this is going to kind of confirm it for you because now you have the cost. And obviously your cost is not going to have any inequalities. So you're sitting there, you're like, oh, okay, that's my objective function. And again, I know what my objective function should look like. It's a linear equation. So this should be, you know, like x1 and this should be x2. And if that's x1 and that's x2, you know, everything above there should technically be x1 and x2. Now, it's not necessarily always going to be like that. You have to double check that it's going to work. But in this case, you know, you can go ahead and see if it's going to work. So if you have that as x1 and that is x2, does the aircraft one make sense? If x1 is the number of Silver Jets and x2 is the number of Golden Flyers, yes, it does. Then you go up to the 2000 x1 and then the x2. You're like, it has less than or equal 2000 and less than or equal to 3000. And you have to think about that. You have to be like, well, what is it talking about? It's talking about the amount of luggage it can, you know, transport. And then you have to think about, well, I'm trying to minimize the cost. So I'm actually trying to minimize the number of flights I have. So you have to think a little bit in the logic way there and be like, oh, well, generally, I'm going to try and fill up the plane as much as possible. And that's when you'll notice, again, that is going to, you know, go away. So once again, the table can help you. It is not everyone's, you know, method of choice. It can be useful for some, which is why I'm bringing it up. But the idea is run through your word problem, ask yourself questions of like, what is my objective function? What is my objective function dependent on? And that's going to help you with decision variables. Try and figure out at least one constraint and see if your constraints decision variables and your objective function decision variables match up. Because they should definitely match up. And then, you know, build it from there.